oxygen. It's all around us, we breathe it, couldn't get by without it. Frankly, maybe we take it for granted. Can you imagine a world without it? Well, take off that imagination hat and look no further than our oceans, because there's a world without oxygen developing right now. And alarmingly, many regions are losing oxygen at a rapidly increasing rate. You may have heard of them. They have names like oxygen minimum zone, hypoxic region, anoxic basin, or chillingly, dead zone. Today, I'm going to refer to them as dead zones just for the drama. These oceanic dead zones have quadrupled in size since 1950 and have increased tenfold in coastal areas. We've already lost 77 billion tons of oxygen in our oceans. When water loses oxygen, organisms suffocate, just like humans would if our atmosphere suddenly lost all of its oxygen. In these dead zones, most marine organisms can't survive. Some fish have adapted to be able to swim away, but many organisms don't have that luxury. Slow-moving organisms, organisms at the bottom of the seafloor, and many larvae are organisms that can't swim away when dead zones set in. We're talking things like crabs, we're talking lobster, we're talking anemones, we're talking beautiful corals, thousands of zooplankton species and larvae. Like, how cute is this guy? Can we not suffocate him, please? Can you imagine the chaos if this happened on land? Imagine if whole cities lost oxygen. Where would people go? What if everyone from Florida had to suddenly move to Alaska and they weren't adapted to that? They probably don't even have a winter coat. That's what happens to fish too. When they lose their homes, they aren't necessarily suited to living somewhere new. To understand these oceanic dead zones and to start a conversation about fixing this problem, we really need to take a step back and do some chemistry. I know, you're all probably really psyched to do chemistry. Well, today we're going to discuss three important chemical reactions. The first one, probably really familiar to all of you. The second one may be the most impressive chemical innovation of human history. And the third one, well, that's a surprise. All right, let's start by examining chemical reaction number one. And to do that, we have to go back a little bit in time. 3.5 billion years ago, our oceans were totally void of oxygen. Microscopic life did exist and was able to survive on other elements like iron and sulfur. But then something chemical happened. About 2.3 billion years ago, some little microscopic dudes were like, hey, let's make some oxygen. And they uncovered what I think is the most important chemical reaction on the planet, photosynthesis. These little ones were able to take carbon dioxide, water, light, and boom, they make oxygen and sugar. Pretty good deal. Since they didn't actually need the oxygen, it accumulated in our oceans and in our atmosphere. Without this chemical reaction, there wouldn't be life on Earth as we know it, and there certainly wouldn't be us on this planet. Okay, let's fast forward. Here we are in 1910. Two handsome, sprightly German dudes named Haber and Bosch changed the world. They developed what may be the most important chemical manufacturing process on the planet, the production of ammonia fertilizer. They did something remarkable. They took nitrogen, which is the dominant element in our atmosphere, and combine it with hydrogen from petroleum to make NH3 or ammonia, commonly known as fertilizer. You know where they got their inspo? Nature, of course. Microorganisms known as diazotrophs have been doing it for years. Honestly, nature should just win the Nobel Prize every time. Anyways, so these two dudes invent fertilizer, and this process fed millions of people worldwide. The Haber-Bosch reaction is thought to be responsible for a tremendous spike in the global population and an increase worldwide in agriculture. But what they didn't consider, and what many of us still don't, is what happens to that fertilizer after we use it on our crops. Let's look at the US. The Mississippi drainage basin is the third largest drainage basin in the world after the Amazon and the Congo. It passes through America's heartland, collecting massive quantities of nitrogen fertilizer along the way, which all winds up in the Gulf of Mexico. The fertilizer in the Gulf of Mexico does the same thing in the ocean as it does on land. It makes things grow. When algae in the ocean receive too much fertilizer, they grow incredibly fast. They grow so fast that large swaths of algae block oxygen from the atmosphere from reaching the ocean. And when they die, their mass decomposition consumes an additional ton of oxygen. This is what causes dead zones in coastal oceans. The dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico is the second largest in the world at over 9,000 square miles. It's estimated that every year, the fishing industry of the Gulf of Mexico loses $2.4 billion as a result of this dead zone. This type of dead zone is cropping up everywhere, including our very own Narragansett Bay. The Narragansett Bay is experiencing critically low bottom water oxygen levels, which you may have noticed if you've ever seen smelly black ooze near, say, Watch Hill or Sandy Point. While it's not a dead zone yet, this is where we're headed. The Narragansett Bay fishing industry supports a variety of fish, like the black sea bass, the flounder, scup, striped sea bass, and menhaden. It's worth an estimated $412 million a year and supports over 4,000 jobs. To change our course and to protect systems like the Narragansett Bay and Gulf of Mexico, I want to turn your attention to our third and final chemical reaction. It's chemical innovation. I know, it's not the silver bullet you were hoping for. But trust me, using scientific innovation and nature as inspiration, we can find a chemical solution to the chemical problem that we've started. Remember that Hottie Haber? Well, he once said the following about his nitrogen reaction. It may be that this solution is not the final one. Nitrogen bacteria teach us that nature, with her sophisticated forms of chemistry of living matter, still understands and utilizes methods which we do not yet know how to imitate. And so that's where we are today. We don't need to imagine an ocean without oxygen, because it's arriving. What we need to do with our imagination instead is to work on a solution for reoxygenating our oceans. We need to put our faith in science. We need to trust human innovation. We desperately need to work together. We can save nature by looking to nature for inspiration, because nature had it right in the first place. So let's learn by listening, watching, and creating.